A new technology is being developed known as quantum computing that represents a new approach to finding solutions to complex problems. My name is Jim Connor. Welcome to Game Changers Silicon Valley. This segment of tonight's show will discuss the application of quantum computing to our most complex problems. My guest is Matt Johnson, founder and CEO of QC Ware, a company that is developing the software that will run quantum computers. Matt, welcome to the show. Let's start with an overview of where we stand today with quantum computing.
First of all, Jim, on behalf of QC Ware, thank you very much for having us with you tonight. So quantum computing hardware and processors have advanced from the experimental and laboratory domain into the engineering groups within the large technology heavyweights. And at this point, the power of those devices is scaling at a good pace, but the performance of these processors still has not been able to outpace classical computing resources.
Mm-hmm. Is the idea that where you're working that the quantum computers themselves will be data center computers primarily? Is there a similar paradigm for quantum computing?
Most people believe that the first generation of commercially deployable quantum computers will simply attach to the cloud. So they'll be remotely located and they'll be called upon to execute certain parts of computationally complex workflows.
The strength of a quantum computer, I assume, is in the calculation area. It's not in the I/O, the database, or any of that type of stuff. Is that correct? That's
precisely right.
Yeah. So what are some of the applications where this will make perhaps a huge difference in the outcomes and the time and the resources used to get an outcome?
So if you talk to computational complexity theorists and computer scientists, they will describe the couple of quantum algorithms that have provable end-to-end speedup. And that is in the domain of quantum chemistry, cryptography, and a couple other areas that I would consider kind of corner cases. So those are areas where there is an established speed up that should be attainable once the underlying quantum computing hardware becomes more powerful. But in addition to that, there are quantum algorithms that have been developed for areas that we would consider to be more mainstream commercial useful. And that would include areas like optimization, quantum machine learning, and other areas where there's computational complexity that could be resolved using quantum processors.
There are several companies building the hardware. Are you building an operating system or the programming languages?
We are building fundamentally application software mm-hmm. that sits on top of the hardware and the APIs that the hardware vendors are producing. And so each hardware vendor, it's taking its own approach as to the compiler and the operating system that it's building to drive calculations on its hardware. And we pay extremely close attention to those developments to make sure that our software complements and doesn't overlap on what's already been built by them. Mm-hmm. And we're really focused on application software. So in the first wave of deployment of the service we intend to deploy, there'll probably be domain-specific libraries for very specific use cases in finance, transport and logistics, and machine learning. And in the second wave, we would like to have fully developed applications that an enterprise user instead of a real programmer or developer can use.
So the first rollout will probably be to the universities and the research centers, is that?
That would be to alpha test the basic mechanics of our vertically integrated applications. The first rollout, we think, when we consider where we think we're going to find initial traction and be able to target some of the low-hanging fruit, will be probably in the areas of quantitative finance, transport and logistics, and potentially some areas of machine learning.
So I've read a few articles over the weekend in anticipation of our interview, and I want to go into one that was deemed to be the more perhaps disruptive area, and that was of cryptography, or essentially keeping transactions secure. The article made the point that when quantum computers make their presence available, that these the cryptography keys will be able to be broken. Is that accurate or
feasible? That is a canonical problem that is discussed widely in quantum computing. So there is an algorithm that has been developed that runs on quantum computers. It's referred to as Shor's algorithm, after the founder, Peter Shor, who's a professor at MIT. And Peter would describe the beauty of this algorithm as being able to break down large numbers, a key, into prime number components. And to get there, in exponentially fewer steps than an arbitrarily large classical computing cluster could get there. So there is the threat that quantum computers would be able to power that sort of a decryption process, yes. The size of a quantum processor that would need to be built in order to outpace a large data center or cluster that would be trying to solve that same problem, a prime factorization problem, would mean you'll probably need millions of qubits. And it will be some time before you've achieved a quantum processor of that size. And the hope is certainly that between now and the time quantum computers have millions of qubits, that groups like ours will be able to identify commercially useful use cases other than cryptography.
You brought up the issue of qubit. Instead of one and zeros on and off, qubits can be a complete range of numbers. Is that correct?
Yes, I think, again, a quantum information sciences theorist would describe a qubit, so that physical matter system. A theorist would explain that you can encode much more information on a qubit than you can on a classical transistor, because there is this nature of this probability as to what the state of that, what that qubit is. It could be a one or it could be a zero at any point in time in the execution of a problem, and it would remain in that superposition state until it collapses into an end state, and at that point, that qubit and the rest of the system reads out as effectively the solution to the problem.
Is there a second tier of how a quantum computer will be constructed? It'll have maybe 16 or 32 qubits, but will have a much greater range of memory?
I think the best way to answer that question is to consider how, let's say, a head of architecture at a large bank or a chemicals company might think of using quantum computing. And that is, they will treat quantum computers as nothing more than a coprocessor or an accelerator that performs a part of a large job. And that means that storage will not play a big part of that, but rather what will happen is you will shunt off a particular computationally complex part of a large problem to the quantum processor and return the result and build that into the overall solution to the problem.
You think the approach will be that this processor, quantum processor, will be in the cloud versus being physically on site?
Yes, I do. And at least for the foreseeable future, that will be the case, because the types of quantum computers that are built now, most of them that are being developed, are based on exploiting the quantum mechanical phenomena that happen when you have superconducting materials that are used as qubits, which means you need to cool these processors that have qubits embedded on them to near absolute zero. So you're talking about a computing system that is vibration dampened, shielded from radio frequency energy, and is certainly going to be remote and heavily cooled.
What kind of resources do you use to cool that? I mean, is it circulating liquid nitrogen?
Well, again, just to take one step back, superconducting qubits are just one of several technologies that are being developed now to build quantum computers. And we should perhaps take a step back and talk about the other approaches. So in addition to superconducting qubits, there are qubits that are built based on something called an ion trap technology. There are photonics-based quantum computers. And there's another class of computers called topological qubits. Those are all computing devices, quantum computing devices, that are being developed now. The end state for quantum computing will be able to embed qubits on something like a silicon substrate and be able to run problems on that at room temperature.
Will that be typically these applications you were speaking of, enterprise applications?
The ability to develop applications is really driven more by the algorithms that would run on any of those arbitrary technology approaches or QC designs that we've talked about. So really the limiting factor to having a very broad set of enterprise applications that could be useful is based on the algorithms that have so far been invented. And as we discussed earlier, there have really only been a handful of quantum algorithms developed that can be mathematically proven to have speed up potential, speed up over classical computing algorithms.
Does the area of space research apply to quantum computing?
It certainly does. It probably will not be a killer app as such, because the underlying market, the number of users, the frequency of use isn't going to be as large. But one area that the government, NASA specifically, cares about as a long-term project would be having a quantum computer in space that would be used to do planning and scheduling. So if you have a vehicle that's traversing the Martian landscape and it needs to make decisions without relaying information or having control inputs from a terrestrial control station, it just needs to figure out what to do, and it's operating under a lot of constraints. So this is potentially a space deployment or employment of quantum computing.
So for practical considerations, what's the ballpark time frame in your mind that quantum computers could start to make an impact or appear in the society?
So I think I would look at it in a couple of phases. I think optimistically, there's an opportunity within the next couple of years to develop prototype enterprise applications that solve real-world problems. And I wouldn't put a specific number on that, but I think that could be very, very near term.
What would be some of the real-world applications?
We think in our company that the first applications, based on everything we've seen, and we've canvassed over 185 enterprises to date to understand their computationally complex problems and to see what could map most readily and most efficiently on a quantum processors, we think that will come from quantitative finance, so risk analytics and risk management. We think it will also come from transport and logistics, so areas like inventory management or routing and scheduling. And a third area that we're hopeful about and that we've really seized upon is quantum machine learning. The promise of quantum machine learning is quite enormous, the attractiveness, because the problem that a lot of enterprises have when they provision machine learning services is that training algorithms that provide these ML services takes up huge workloads in data centers, and it takes a lot of time and it requires a lot of data. If you could more efficiently train algorithms to provide machine learning services, you'd be solving a very big problem. Quantum computers have the potential to address that. This is still somewhat speculative, but our company in particular is seizing on that as something we really want to develop and capitalize on.
I think I hear you saying that quantum computers will be more efficient at learning from watching things take place transaction-wise, watching events happen, and learn from that experience and have a much higher level of decision-making accuracy.
I guess in this particular case, and this could be a conversation that could go off on a lot of tangents, but I think what I'm comfortable expressing is that in our view, quantum processing has the capability to more efficiently train an algorithm that is used to provision a service, which means that could mean that it requires much less data and much less time to train that service.
So I hadn't heard this term, train an algorithm.
That is a term that machine learning and data scientists, experts use a lot, but it simply has to do with teaching a computer, if you will, a set of rules that it uses to predict or classify. That might be the easiest way to describe that.
So Matt, how did you get into this field? How did you arrive at this? Was it you went to Stanford, or a little bit about your
background? No, my case, I went to the Air Force Academy undergrad, and I started out as an Air Force officer. I spent 5 years in the Air Force working on effectively communications programs and reconnaissance programs. I got out of the military, went back to business school, and then spent about 19 years in Europe working in finance, and about the second half of that career was in private equity, which is like venture capital, but it's for larger firms. 6 years ago, I came back to the United States, and I decided that I wanted to try to build a company in the aerospace and defense domain, to get behind that with a group of co-founders. And I started traveling around to DOD, Department of Defense research labs, and other government laboratories around the country, looking for technologies that I thought were on a tipping point between being a science project and a commercializable business. When I came out to Ames Research Center, I was fortunately introduced to the quantum computing team, and that was about 5 years ago. So the foundation of the company was to establish a collaborative research and development agreement with NASA Ames's quantum computing group, where our charter under that agreement was to develop applications that would run on early quantum computers. And we formed a team of a couple of co-founders and myself 3.5 years ago, set up the company, and since then we've been building these applications that we described. We're based in Palo Alto, and we will be very soon opening up an office in Europe to address what is comparatively high demand among large enterprises in Europe to get more exposure and familiarity with this technology. And I'd also like to call your viewers' attention to a very major quantum computing conference that QC Ware, Google, and NASA have organized, which will be held at NASA Ames Research Center from the 4th through the 6th of December. It will have a lot of participation from the industry players who are doing the really hard work, which is building the hardware. That's really the hardest thing. We're just standing on the shoulders of giants there as a part of the software ecosystem. But this will be quite fascinating. The website for that is Q2B, so Q2B.us.
Thank you so much for your time, your insight. I've thoroughly enjoyed this. I want to wish you every success going forward.
I really appreciate it, Jim. Our whole company does. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Okay. This is Jim Conner. Thank you for joining us for this week's episode of Game Changer Silicon Valley. Each week, we'll address an area of innovation that may emerge as a game changer of tomorrow. You can contact us or subscribe to our shows at gamechangers.tv. We look forward to your continued participation and interest in upcoming shows.